Let everyone in the listening audience grab their scriptures, a pencil, and a piece of paper. Listen and learn the true meaning of the Old and New Testament of the Bible, the Psalms of David, the Lost Books, and the Holy Quran. There are no more secrets. All false things will perish. So come and learn the undisputable teachings of the only man that has the answers to the problems of a troubled world, As-Sayyid al-Imam Isa al-Hadi al-Mahdi.
Being Allah is the all-knower, and he knew man was going to become...
Let me just say this. It's amazing you're asking that, because in our study department this morning with the sisters who asked, we had the same discussion. And nowhere in the Quran, nowhere in the Torah, nowhere in the Injil, nowhere in the Zabor, nowhere in the Holy Scriptures does it say that Allah knows things that are going to happen. If you open the Holy Quran to the 4th chapter, the 111th verse, it'll tell you something other than that. It'll say Allah is knowing wise, but notice what it says. 4:111.
And whoever commits a sin, he only commits it against his own soul, and Allah is knowing wise.
Notice that. And it says, and whoever does any wicked deed, he's only doing it against himself. He ain't doing nothing against Allah. And Allah is what? Aliman Hakiman, the knowing, the wise. It never ever says Allah knows. People always say that. Well, if Allah knows everything is going to go by, why did he let it happen? It never says that. Allah knows things. To know something is after the incident. You follow that? Predestination is man's own doing. The Almighty created man and gave him free will, which is proven by the book of Genesis chapter 3, when he gave man a right to take of the tree in the garden for which he was forbidden. Man has the right to take a good action and turn it evil. The gift of the fruit is good. The partaking of it when it's forbidden is evil. That is done out of man's own will. No, don't say Allah knows everything you're going to do tomorrow. Because that breeds people into saying when a person falls down the stairs that Allah was angry at them as opposed to them just being stupid. It's very easy to blame it on Allah in a subtle kind of way when people say, see what happened to that brother? He lost his business. That means Allah is angry at him. He lost his business because he was a bad businessman, not because Allah is angry at him, because there's a bunch of people that don't even serve the Almighty that's quite successful in business. And a lot of people don't have no belief in the Almighty and fall down and break their legs. You understand that? So it's wrong when men does that. They put Allah on the spot. I'm going to give you a perfect example of what I'm talking about. You ever see somebody with a cross hanging in the dashboard of their car? You ever seen that? Somebody got a cross hanging there? And that's God to them, right? Suppose they get in an accident after that. Whose fault is it, God or theirs, for putting God to the test? You don't take it upon yourself to put a cross in your car unless you're going to be driving as accurately as God would if he was there. But if you put the cross there and I drive by and see the car crashed up with the cross, I lose faith in God because of some stupid thing you did. You see what I'm saying? We got to stop taking man's opinions, man's ideas, and giving them to God, and judging the Holy Scriptures by man. No, doesn't say anywhere in the Scripture that he knows everything is going to happen to everybody in the world. No. He gave man free will, and believe me, blindness, sickness, disease, and all the other things in the world, we are responsible for ourselves. We do it ourselves. We deform our children ourselves. The sins of the fathers fall upon the children, even unto the fourth generation, the Scripture says. We are responsible for our own evils, and we will not blame it on the Heavenly Father. Go ahead.
Okay.
Someone in Acts writes, at what point in the creation did the dinosaurs take place? Like, where were the span when they were created? I mean, I know they existed, but...
You know, that's a good question, because there's different types of dinosaurs. Y'all seem to be up on this evolution thing. Right?
I just was curious.
Dinosaurs happen to be in the Bible under the word whale.
Whale?
Yeah, in Genesis, when it says, and he created the great whales.
Uh-huh.
Well, that is the mammal, and that was the birth of the dinosaur. Right? That's in Genesis chapter 20. Now, if you study the days of evolution in this creation, because remember, evolution is in creation.
Right.
When they say Allah said kun fayakun, exist, and things came into existence, that was the essence of life. Then evolution took place. Man is evolution, not from an ape, though. White man evolution from an ape, not a black man.
Yeah, yeah.
And if you shave the hair of an ape, you'll find out he's white.
That's right.
Now, 20, what does it say? And God said, let the waters bring forth abundantly moving creatures that have life. Mm-hmm. Right? So that means he placed in these creatures the seed to reproduce life. Evolution is mentioned by that statement, that have life. Once you say creatures, you know they're alive, but that have life. And fowl that may fly above the earth in the open firmament of heaven. That's the firmament between the earth, planet, and the spheres.
Hmm.
That's the firmament, okay?
Yeah.
And God created great whales and every living creature that moveth. You see that?
Yeah.
This is the creation of the dinosaurs.
Hmm.
They were thousands and thousands of years before the creation of man.
Right.
All right?
Yes.
Certain species of dinosaurs, which were reptiles, evoluted into an upright creature also, who walks on two and has five fingers, but he has webs between them.
Right.
And they were taken and gone to another galaxy. They now come back and visit.
Yeah.
All right?
Yes.
You had other civilizations of people that were taken during a period of time, taken off the planet. For instance, the Mayan people. The Mayan people were taken to another galaxy. Some of them went down into Agartha, where Shambhala is, or Wahala, the city in the center of the world. Others were taken to other galaxies.
Right.
A lot of empires of people, whole civilizations have disappeared because extraterrestrials came and took them the same way they want to take you, but you won't go.
Hmm.
So the creation of the dinosaurs and stuff was during this period of time.
All right.
The destruction of the dinosaurs were after that time when the planet was hit by a large meteorite, which caused a great sandstorm, which eliminated all living things on the planet. But the seed of life was still in the water, thus man came out of water. This is why in El Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in one place, I created man of the dust of the earth, and in another place he said, I created man from water. He says from El Ma. And most scholars of Islam don't know what they mean, so they say, oh, he must have put the water in the dust and made mud. He doesn't say that. He says clay, which is different.
Right.
Clay is already shaped from water and certain types of stone, but not dust. You follow?
Yes.
The reason why Allah makes that distinction is because originally he created man a spark of life in the heavens. Man was then shaped on the dust of the ground, and he breathed into man the breath of life. Man was destroyed on the planet Earth, just like the dinosaurs were, and the life germ of man was still in the water, and it came out of the amoeba. And evoluted back into what you are today. This was thousands and thousands of years. By the time man became perfected, that was your Adam, and that was about 45,000. Well, if you multiply it by 7, because each day is equivalent to 7,000 years, and each one of those multiply into 7, because he says one day is like unto 1,000 years to the Lord, 1,000 years is like to one day. That's why in the Holy Quran, one time they make a statement about the creation of man, and they say over 10,000 years, another time they say in one day. And that's another thing that scholars get confused about, the creation. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, it took me just to say kun for you to come into existence as a life form, and then ja'ala, I made you into what you became. Mm-hmm. Two different words to use in Arabic.
Right.
All right? And that's why you have a creation of man mentioned in Genesis 1, and then you'll have another creation of man, like for instance, in Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, he says what?
And Allah said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth.
All right, now go on, 27.
So Allah created man in his own image. In the image of Allah created he him, male and female created he them.
Mm-hmm. Then when you go to Genesis chapter 2, verse 7.
And the Lord Allah formed man of the dust of the ground, and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life.
So one was his creation as life itself,
right.
And the next was the formation of his body. Because in chapter 2, verse 4, it tells you about how the angelic beings and the earthly beings were created. These are the generations of the what?
Heaven. Of the heavens.
And of
the earth.
See, because Adam was first created from the beings of the heavens, right. Then created of the beings of the earth. And go on.
When they were created.
When they were created. What they? They, the beings of the heaven. Allah says he is khalaqa. He created kulli shayin fi samawati wal arda. He created everything in the galactic heavens and everything in the planet earth. And so he just said, these are the generations of samawati, the heavens, wal arda, and the planet earth, when they were created in the day that Allah made. See, made now is the evolution process,
right.
The earth and the heaven. He went from creation to made. There is a difference. You make something from things here. You create something from things non-existent. And in two different words, khalaq and ja'ala. Okay?
Yes. Shukran.
Tell me, if Genesis is not the beginning of history, what happened before Genesis?
What happened before Genesis is mentioned in the book of Revelations, chapter 12, verse 7, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the war of the angels in heaven. It's also mentioned in the books of Ephesians 9, when it speaks about Lucifer and the angels living in heaven. So the heavenly abode, which the Quran refers to as Malakut, existed before the physical abode, which Allah refers to as Nasut, the physical plane. So there were 76 trillion years of existence of angelic beings before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam. Angels had realms and realms that existed before the earth, which is proven by the scriptures that he said, I created the heavens and the earth and the host of them. You follow that? Right in Genesis it says that Allah created the heavens and the earth and the host of them. So therefore, there was angels in heaven when they said, when they spoke to Allah, said, will thou create one in the earth, the Quran says. Will thou create one in the earth that will cause mischief and shed blood? Because they glorify his praise, which meant that when they were talking to him, the earth nor this being had been created yet. Therefore, the angels, according to the Quran, I'm just quoting from the Quran, had to be with Allah somewhere other than the earth. And it says Allah is the Lord of the galactical heavens and the planet earth and all the hosts of them. So man is now the resident of the planet earth because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put him here. Obviously, the angels, like I mentioned before, if you go to Revelation chapter 12, verse 7, obviously was not dwelling in the earth plane. They must have been dwelling somewhere else. And if they were cast down from the heaven, like Allah said after he created Adam, get ye all of you down from here. He sent them down to the earth. He said, in the earth, some of y'all will be enemies to each other. So they must have resided in an angelic state first. In Revelation chapter 12, verse 7, it says, and there was war in the heavens. And Michael and his angels fought against the dragon and his angels, and prevailed not, neither was their place found any more in heaven. And the great dragon was cast out, the old serpent called the devil and Satan, right? Which deceived the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. Okay? These are the angelic beings that were once residing in Jannah, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the ruh of Adam, the soul of Adam. And then when Allah cast them out of heaven into the earth, that was 57,000 years prior to this day. Okay? What's the next question?
Okay, the spiritual master, you say it's one who masters the physical and the spiritual plane.
Yes, a spiritual master is one that masters the spiritual and the physical plane.
Okay, so, I mean, can't you have some proof? I mean, something to show
proof,
is it just what you have in your book and just what you say? Because if you give me a certain amount of information, I can write books.
Right. Can I ask you a question?
Yes.
Do you have a spirit?
I assume so.
Do you have a soul, at least?
Yes.
Can you prove it to me?
I can prove it.
Yeah, go ahead. Show me.
By the fact that it says in Genesis that he made him a living soul.
Yeah, but some man wrote Genesis, remember? That's a book, too. This is a book.
Excuse me?
The book. You could have learned this from the book. Prior to the book. You're asking me to show it to you without the books. I'm saying that the proof of my knowledge is how old my spirit is. If I eliminate the books of Allah, I can't prove it. So I'm asking you to prove to me that you have a soul, but don't use the books of Allah.
No, I hear what you're saying. You're saying by using the scriptures, you prove that you're a spiritual master.
It's the knowledge. It's not me, I'm nothing. You cannot get all the knowledge that I've given you in books. If you can, go find it.
See, that brings me back to my point. I don't know if it's knowledge or not.
Well, when it confirms itself by other scriptures, it is.
Okay, the 200 angels.
Uh-huh.
Where is that confirmed in the scriptures? And where are their names in the scriptures? You say that is a book, Suhufan.
Just a minute.
I have no idea where that book came from.
Well, that's because you're probably not reading the scriptures. If you read, I'm not saying you're not reading them at all, but if you read the Holy Quran, right, the 98th chapter, 2 and 3, it speaks about the Suhufan. It tells you about them. It tells you throughout the Quran about the pages of the Suhufan. It has mention of it, literally, the Suhufan. It says the Suhufan of Abraham and Moses. It's mentioned in the last verse of the Surah of the Most High, Surah Al-A'la. What happens is, a lot of American brothers who have been influenced by Arabs who don't have the knowledge of it, of the Suhuf, they just say this means pages. They don't bother to explain these things. But I'm saying if you take the time, like I noticed that I mentioned the quote, but we didn't look it up.
Excuse me?
I mentioned the quote, but we didn't even bother to look it up. I mean, if we want to find the answers to the question, it's only fair that we do search out the answer. You're asking me a question, I'm trying to give you an answer, but you're not looking the quote up. And there's a quote in the Quran that talks about the soul.
Oh, because I don't doubt that that's in there.
So then why do you doubt that it exists?
What I'm saying is, in order for you to show me something from a book supposedly that was just recently opened.
Yes, I understand that.
Mm-hmm. How do I know that that comes from that book?
By bringing the likes of it that you come up with. Bring to me the Suhufan. How come the Arabs...
But how can that be satisfactory? Because anything someone produces, they can say, bring the like of this, and if I can't do it, I have to accept it.
Well, that's what the Quran,
that's not satisfactory effort.
Well, I'm the one that's quoting you the Quran when it says, when people say to Muhammad about the scripture, how do we know it's from Allah? He said to say to them, bring the likeness of it and produce it without using it. I'm just quoting you the Quran again.
Okay,
that's what Allah says. Wait a minute, it's not that easy. The point is that the Arab world, I mean, people who know the language, scholars of the language, have not attempted to come forth and present where the Suhufan is, what it is, or how it got there. There are certain Arabs now that are talking about it, because I was at a lecture recently with an Egyptian, and his name is Jamal Bedri, and in his lectures he spoke about the Suhufan of Abraham and the Suhufan of Moses. But when it came down to just what the Suhufan is, when asked, he said he doesn't know. Is it the fact that I am not a white Arab? Is that the problem?
Oh, no, no. Because I have no problem with white, black, or any of that.
A lot of people do, though, even though they don't admit it, you know, because they accept the Prophet Muhammad.
Well, I put it like this. If I do, I don't know it. It's not a question of me not wanting to admit
it. Yeah, I understand. So, have you read the Suhuf from our pamphlets? Any of it?
Parts, yes.
And have you been able to find anything in it that you couldn't prove or that you didn't believe?
No, because most of it corroborates with the rest of the scriptures.
So what is the problem?
The problem is, if I read the scriptures, I have a great knowledge of the scriptures. I can write something and say this is a suhoof.
That's what I'm saying. Don't you read the scriptures? Don't you read the scriptures? You just
said
it. Then write something like it. That's what I just asked. I agree with you.
And in order for me to do that, then that would be deception. So why would I do that?
Because you're going to prove a point. You're going to prove that I made it up.
No, I'm not trying to prove that you made it up.
No, I'm saying you would be able to, if you...
I'm asking you to prove that this is a suhoof.
I did, by putting it out. Okay, let me ask you a question. The Quran itself, right?
Yes.
What is the first chapter of the Holy Quran?
Al-Fatiha.
No, it's not.
Well, you tell me then.
The clock is the first chapter of the Holy Quran.
Okay.
Now, that's a normal mistake. Had you been teaching a class, the people would have left the class assuming that Fatiha was the first chapter of the Holy Quran. Because you would have to come back later.
But if you had asked which chapter was revealed first, then that would have been a different question.
Okay, then which chapter was revealed first?
I think it was the 96.
The Surah of the Clock. How do you know that?
I've read it. When I read about Prophet Muhammad.
Where did you read that?
I've read it in books.
I'm not trying to be funny, I'm just trying to show you the line of how questions work. Where did you read it at?
Several versions of Quran.
You read it in the Quran?
Yes.
That the 96th chapter of the Holy
yes.
Quran was...
not Quran, the versions of the Quran,
yes.
Where they have parts about the Prophet's life and so forth.
Right. And now, how do you know that in those tafsirs, because it doesn't say that in the Quranic text, it says that in the interpretations of the text written by men, is that correct? It doesn't say in the Holy Quran that Surah Al-Alaq was the first revelation.
Right.
It's in the explanations at the bottom written by men.
Mm-hmm.
How do you know that what they said was true?
I don't.
But you believe it.
It doesn't matter if I believe it or not.
Well, you
what
said
what matters is my faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Right, but you said it, so you must believe it. When I asked you which one it was, you said it was the clock, so you must believe it. But when we read the Holy Quran presently, we see, like you said, that Alhamd is the first surah. But they've altered Alhamd to Allah, correct?
They've altered it to
they've
what?
They've moved the formation of the Quran from the way it was revealed to the way it is today.
Mm-hmm.
But because somebody wrote it on the bottom, you believed them. Did you question them?
Well, it's not that I saw it written on the bottom. I mean biographies, so-called biographies of...
which were written by people before you, because all of it is written by men. Right?
Yes.
Did you question them?
Yes.
You're telling me that you questioned Yusuf Ali?
I couldn't question them, not Yusuf Ali, people who have written biographies
yes.
on the Prophet, mm-hmm. alayhi salam's life.
I'm talking about on the fact that you believed that the clot, which was originally revealed 1, and Fatiha, which was originally revealed 5, when you decided to believe that that was a fact, did you question the tafsir writer of the scripture or book that you got that fact from, the way you questioned me? I'm just reaching at a point.
Well, they weren't available the way you
okay.
are.
Okay, I understand that. My point is that people only question certain people. That is my point. That's one of the things I teach. I teach that people will always question me. They won't go question these white Arabs in here teaching, not
well,
freely, or Warwick D. Muhammad. They let Farrakhan give a lecture, they won't question him with the aggressiveness that they do me.
But Minister Farrakhan doesn't claim to have 76 million years of knowledge.
Minister Farrakhan claims to speak to God directly.
Well,
that's
I
a little older
that.
Than 76 trillion years of knowledge.
But in the same way, when you're dealing with a spiritual master, which you say that you are, the spiritual master, his intimate disciples, from the ancient Eastern tradition, they refer to him as God.
You've jumped from a spiritual master in our doctrine to Hinduism.
And, oh, so your doctrine is different.
No, I didn't say my. Listen again. Our.
Well, your is
meaning,
plural and
my second. Meaning ours Muslims, not ours Hindus or Brahma.
Okay, but your is plural here.
Huh?
When I say your, I'm saying plural.
I thought you meant your, because your in English can be single or plural. Yes, my in the sense of as a group of Muslims. We believe a spiritual master is something different than the Hindus do.
How can a spiritual master be different?
Because the interpretations of God to a Buddhist and the interpretations of Allah to a Muslim is different. And they both will use the word God. The interpretations to a Catholic of Jesus being God in the form of a statue and the interpretations to a Lutheran of Jesus being God in an incarnation as
but
a spirit.
But me and you both know that all the religions, the interpretation of God is the same.
That's wrong. I disagree
different.
With you.
Why
I disagree with you because there's feminine gods in Egypt and Allah cannot be feminized. I disagree. There's goddess and Muslims know that Allah cannot be made into a woman.
So you're saying goddess as far as the English language?
I'm saying goddess as far as the Hindu language and the Hebrew language and other languages they may be speaking at the time. It makes them make female gods or dogs gods. Or cows gods, or monkeys gods. Are you telling me that as a Muslim, the Hindus believe that monkeys are gods, and you think because they say that, Allah is a monkey?
No.
Is that what you're telling me?
No.
So there is different definitions of God. You understand? And
okay.
the Quran
makes... But the religions are the same.
No, they're not the same.
They're not the same.
You know, religions are not the same.
So they're not different paths leading to the same goal?
That's a different statement. Now you're changing. Let's answer each question one by one. No, religions are not the same because in the Buddhist faith, they go before a gold statue and prostrate. All right? In the Christian faith, they go before a plastic or plaster statue and raise their hands. In the Sikh religion, they lay on their side and there's no statue. And in Islam, we just face the Qibla. So now, if that's a way of saying to get from here to Manhattan, you take a train and I take a bus and he'll take a car, and because we take different means of transportation, we're going to the same place, you're wrong. Because according to this Quran, if you're not worshiping Allah, you're not going to heaven. So therefore, people who worship Buddha and Krishna and any other who says they are Allah are not going to heaven if they worship these things, because Allah says that. Now, pertaining to the Suhufan again, which I was trying to get back to, if you open your Quran, I was hoping that you open the Quran to the 87th chapter and the 19th verse and the 18th verse, it's going to say something. It says, you see it?
No, I don't have it yet. What is the name of that surah?
The Most High. The Allah, the 87th.
Okay, I have it.
If you read 17, 18, and 19, what do you see?
This is in the former scrolls, the books of Abraham and Musa.
Okay, and let's go to the second chapter, the 136th verse, to find out what are the scriptures of Moses and Abraham. 2:136 will tell us at least which one Moses is.
Mm-hmm.
Are you with me?
Yes.
What does it tell us here?
We believe in Allah and that which is revealed unto us and that which was revealed to Abraham and Ishmael and Isaac and Jacob and the tribe.
It stopped there. It covered four names. And then it went into tribes. Okay? All of this is before Moses. Alright?
Mm-hmm.
Then it goes on to say, what ma'a uti and what was given, right?
Mm-hmm.
The Musa, which we know is the what? According to the Quran. The Torah.
Mm-hmm.
And then it says, and what was given, wa Isa, which we know from the Quran is the Injil. And then it says, and what was given to the prophets from their sustainer, which means that they're talking about prophets with Musa and Jesus. Oh, that would be the books of Jeremiah, Isaiah, and etc., not the tribes before that, because the tribe before that was mentioned. I'm just trying to reach a point.
Mm-hmm.
All right? Then it says we don't make any distinctions in any of them. The point I'd like to raise is that if the Quran clearly says that Abraham received a scripture, and it just separated Abraham's scripture from Moses, which would be the Torah, right, or the Old Testament. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Where and what is Abraham's scripture?
The
Quran tells us about it. It calls it in that 87th chapter, if you look at it, it calls it 87:19 and 87:18, the Suhuf, literally, it says it. But I don't think the argument is there a Suhuf?
No.
The argument is, do I, as a, what you might know as a black man in America,
no,
which of course don't mean nothing in America, because you're not a racist, as you say, right? Do I have it? I am convinced, my point is, I'm convinced that if some white Arab would have presented a book and called it the Suhuf, all the Sunnis would have accepted it. That's my point. If some white Arab from Arabia or from Egypt came across with a book and said, this is the Suhuf of Abraham, the way they came to y'all here and gave y'all a Yusuf Ali and a Maulana Muhammadi translation and a Pictor translation of the Quran and said, this is the Quran, and the Sunni Muslim will fight with us on the, they'll do battle with us on the merits of this man's translation. They don't speak the language yet because they're still studying it. But they will argue with us on Yusuf Ali's translation of the Quran as being correct, or Maulana Muhammad Ali's translation of the Quran, and not even question their translation for years when being around State Street and being around Darussalam and around other so-called Sunni Muslims, they never questioned the translation or the ability of the translator the way they're questioning me. And again, I repeat, had I been Yusuf Ali or one of those guys, and I presented you with a book and called it the Suhuf of Abraham, and it was written the same way that book is, which, as you said, appears to match the other scriptures, you understand?
Mm-hmm.
I would never have this conversation. I'd be all right.
As far as, was it looked upon it the same way it is, as for what we understand that to sin is, or if, you know, law was, it was the law, but wasn't prescribed in a way that we actually see what law is that we know about, or was it different, right?
First of all, history is a misunderstanding between law and commandment. Okay? commandments are things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala orders a person to do that must be done then. You can only violate a commandment once. You follow? But laws are things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us to do over a period of time. If you violate a commandment, you've broken a covenant with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Unless he adds everlasting covenant, which means he gives you the chance to redo it again. So if he makes a commandment like in Israel, do not worship any other deities, and indeed they went and worshiped Baal, he erased them. But when it comes down to not keeping the Sabbath, he left the decision of judgment on the priest. So oftentimes, when a man violated the law, he was judged by the priest. When he violated a commandment, he was judged by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Same thing applies to sin. The priest started saying those things which were law were sins. So when you violated the law, you were sinning. Therefore, deifying themselves to make decisions like stone him to death. And the moment the priest took it upon himself to stone you to death because you violated the law, not the commandments of Allah, but the laws that Allah gave man to live by, he violated a commandment. Thou shalt not fight to kill each other. You see what I'm saying? Thou shalt not kill, as they say. Really means thou shalt not fight to kill each other amongst the Israelites. So there's a variety of judgments based on the type of wrong that one does. Another thing to understand is this. In the Quran, sin and in Torah, sin are different. Though they share the same thing, meaning to tell a lie is a sin, to steal is a sin, to take another Muslim or Israelite's life is a sin. Now I'll give you a perfect example of what I mean. In the commandments, when they say, thou shalt not fight to kill, or thou shalt not kill, a lot of people think that means everybody in the whole world. Unless they read the book of Exodus and see that the Israelites went out killing people and fought against people and took lives. So therefore, all the children of Israel will be guilty of violating the law. And the same thing would be applied to Al-Islam, because Rasulullah Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and his companions fought battles and had to kill people. You follow? But the Quran and the scriptures did tell them not to kill each other, the Quran kept saying. And one Muslim shouldn't kill another Muslim. And in Israel, y'all should not kill each other. It didn't mean nothing about the Amalekites and the Moabites and the Hittites and the Hevites and the Arkites. They were not supposed to fight and kill amongst each other. So if a man killed somebody from another tribe, the Israelites didn't write that down as a sin, you see. But if they killed another Israelite, that was a sin punishable by death. Who made the decision? The priest made the decision. Who were the priests? The enforcers of the law. So now the priests weave themselves from being just enforcers of the laws of Allah and until the executors, and in a subtle kind of way, Allah himself. Because the moment you can take a life, because the scripture says Allah gives life and he takes life. The moment a person has the power to sentence someone to death, then they're acting the part of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You understand? So the scriptures have different opinions on sin. For instance, Muslims say it's a sin to drink wine. Correct? The Quran doesn't say that. The Quran says it's a sin to get drunk. They blame the Jews by saying the Jews, or the, I shouldn't say Jews, I should say Judah, the tribe of Judah of Israel, of exaggerating the law. Correct? And Muslims exaggerated the law. Everything is all blown out of proportion. For instance, the Quran clearly tells us that we should not take khumra. Khumra means anything that blocks our intellect. They say, oh, khumra, khumra means wine. Nabid means wine. Khumra means intoxicant. And they were addressing getting intoxicated to the point where people would enter into the prayer or into any religious service without a clear mind. Any type of heroin, cigarettes, hashish, ganja, or anything else, that is a sin, because that's an intoxicant, a poison. Wine is not an intoxicant, a poison. In fact, wine is a therapy often for cleaning the blood system. I'm trying to do it this way so you can see how mortals step in into the commandments of Allah and pervert them to suit themselves. Now people say, wow, Imam Isa just said we could go out and get drunk. He said we could drink wine, but don't get drunk. I didn't say that. I said that in the scriptures, Allah never said don't drink wine. He said don't get drunk. Now you can determine at what point you're getting drunk, because most of the time when someone says you're drunk, you don't believe it. They have to say stop drinking, you're drunk. I ain't drunk. So therefore, don't touch it, because you ain't got the power to control it. It'll control you, and you'll end up taking what is lawful and turning it into a sin. So when you ask just point blank, what is a sin? Sins are so sensitive, because men are now have stepped so much into the law, men have become so prominent in the law because people are living by books of men like the Hadith and the Mishnah and all those things, that men are making sins out of things that wouldn't ordinarily be sins, and commandments out of things that were just law. And do you understand the difference, people, between a law and a commandment? Do you understand that, at least?
Yes,
that
yes,
laws are things that you have to abide by. Commandment is something he says, don't do that. Keeping a prayer is a law. Taking a person's life is violating of a commandment. So sin becomes a very touchy subject. And I would have to be asked specifically about a specific subject before I give a sensible or an intelligent answer according to the Sunnah of Rasulullah Muhammad.
Thank you.
With the masses right now being deceived and new drugs constantly being put in our community, is there anything that me, a Muslim, or someone else who's a Muslim who's not in the garments that you wear, that we can be doing to be hands or instruments of Allah in gathering the brothers just together, our sisters just together?
The answer to the question is very difficult, because what it is that in order for us to do something to help the children, which is what we're talking about, not me and yourself who are grown, but to help the future generation, we need certain things. One is we need a doctrine. We can't tell them, like the Nation of Islam, that the white man was a devil, and don't even give them any facts to prove it other than a couple of pamphlets and sheets that people wrote. Because the point is that, like you said, the adversary is another word of saying the devil. Okay? The one who's actually perpetrating all this stuff, or genocide, all the words we learn out of Webster's Dictionary to mean that the devil is out to get us and destroy us as a people. And in the process is destroying his own people. Now, as far as we're concerned, because Rasulullah Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which you know is the Prophet Muhammad, had a prescribed way for doing things. He said that he is the best of examples for us, or the best way. Okay, the Quran supports this. So therefore, Rasulullah has certain things he wanted us to do in order for us to succeed. Okay? So when you say we Muslims who are not in the garb, what you're really saying is we people who call ourselves Muslims but who do not want to follow the Sunnah of Muhammad to the letter, or follow the way that Muhammad said do it. We don't have a crime problem here in our community. We don't have a drug problem with our children. We don't have any of those things that are outside of the tabernacle, because the books of Revelation says in the 22nd chapter that all these things will be outside the tabernacle. The only way for you and any other brother and sister who say they're Muslims to be of an asset is for all of us to come together, because in unity there is power. You follow that? If all of us would align ourselves on the tariq of Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and live in his example, follow his patterns, and his pattern and his example works for us. Because remember that the Ansarullah community is predominantly a group of Caribbean people, Puerto Rican people, Arabs, and American Negroes who come together for something that they all believe in. We put their trust in the Mujaddid, who's a reformer, who laid down things and said, if you follow this way, we will succeed. Because he is only going to tell you what Muhammad was told by the angel Jibril from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Answer is that the only way to change the conditions of a people is to first change yourself. You follow that? Thus, we have to follow someone who had succeeded, who was successful in what they did. And Muhammad was that example the Quran teaches us. So therefore, we got to dress like him, think like him, walk like him, talk like him, and then put this in our children, and they will not fall victim to the devil. We got to set up our own television stations, our own radio stations, our own educational system, our own buying and selling, our own farms. We must buy from each other and sell to everybody else. You follow? We must have strong union, and that strong union is in faith, iman. We must have big faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his ability to overcome all obstacles. Because we in the Jama'a Ansarullah had that kind of faith, all of the other communities that opposed us, regardless of how big they were, are all falling to the wayside. Yet we're getting stronger and stronger and stronger. Because while they were basing their communities on foreign exportation and influence of Arabs from different places and all kind of things that were not faith, all the Ansarullah had to go on was faith. And in that faith, our pride. Brothers went out, men who were PhDs, had masters, bachelor's degrees, who had academic qualities, vocational qualities, went out on the subways and solicited. We laid all our pride down and we went out and solicited in the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Back in the 70s when everybody else was calling us beggars and signers and fools and etc. Now when we reach the 80s, we, by the grace of Allah and His help, because He says if you take one step towards Him, He'll take 10 towards you. So we followed that sunnah and took one step in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's way, laid down our pride and our personal feelings about things, you see, and came together as a family, a ahl. We followed and aligned ourselves to live the sunnah of Muhammad and not say we are Sunni and read a bunch of books, but to live it every day, to try to set up the Sharia and the fiqh inside a jamaah. And that's what we tell everybody. The more people that come to the community, the stronger we become and the more protecting force we have for our children against shaitan. You cannot be in his world and not of it. If you're in that world, in order to survive, somewhere along the line, you're going to have to lean on his shoulder. Because he has it set up that way, where if you're out there in his world, you will be dependent on him. It doesn't mean that we have overcome all of his obstacles, but it does mean that as the Ansarullah community grows and we get stronger with the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the unity is giving us strength. Our communities are spreading everywhere. They follow, and they all are following one simple thing, Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and acknowledge it after him, ba'adahu, came Ja'ad al-Mahdi Muhammad Ahmed ibn Abdullah, and he came because he knew that after Muhammad, men would start to deviate and alter and change because of egos and create sectism, and then the Mahdi came, which is the man behind you on the wall, to correct that. And here we are 100 years later in a land that is not ours, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has shined the light on us. So the answer again to the problem is, you cannot help the people outside until you help yourself. Until you get your example, because the children have to look at you and say, do I want to think like him? Do I want to dress like him? How should I eat? What should I eat? When should I eat? How should I pray? What should I say? When should I pray? How should I do this? When do we laugh? When do we cry? What games do we play? What games don't we play? How do we address certain sicknesses? How do we address it? If a brother just has a good heart, maybe like yourself, you may have a good heart with beautiful intentions, but do not have the information to raise a nation, you get many people confused. Like Minister Farrakhan has a very good heart, but he doesn't have the information to raise a nation the way the Honorable Elijah Muhammad did. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad had the information to raise a nation. You follow that? So he was able to initiate a certain dress code, what to eat, what you call how to eat to live, and what he did, but he didn't have the doctrine to hold him. He said the pig was man-made, but he didn't explain it. He said that Yaqub made a devil, but he couldn't explain it. You follow what I'm saying? Lots of little things that never was explained, which were in the Quran, but because he didn't have the language, he couldn't see them. But that was not his job. His job was to prepare you for our coming. He was to lay the foundation, and we was to finish the house. You see? So it's all in your example. If you want to prevent the children from going towards crack and the new drugs, you have to set up a community and re-educate them yourself. And have an example in yourself that they can follow. And remember, as a man, it becomes very difficult because when you raise little girls, their whole outlook on life is different, their living systems are different, their medical conditions are different, and you have to be quite informed. It's more difficult than just grabbing a band of people and getting together and say we form a jam. It doesn't work like that. We learned that through trial and error. As we matured and watched our little girls grow up from little teeny babies into grown women, we found that life is very difficult. In order for you to keep your children out of the hands of the dragon or the beast, you've got to have an example to follow, and you must follow it to the letter consistently, like we have for the last 20 years, consistently. So when you raise that children in a way, they will never depart, the Bible says. You follow?
Yes, and I see the community is already established. So when I ask that question, I know the backbone and the foundation is already here. So now I want to say this, that I see in the scriptures, anytime Allah brought the masses together, first He brought them together in large groups, maybe in a state of praise, gathering to praise Allah. And then from there, did He pick His fruit? And I guess this is more what I'm asking is it time yet for we to go into the communities and begin just gathering the masses in praise? and then from that, letting them know what is how we have the school set up, because I know you have that, the understanding of the scriptures, you have that. So to teach people, we have all that here, but to get the masses first, I'm saying, how can we do this? And I'm saying, like, just gathering them in praise, is that one way? And if so, is it too soon to just start going across the country, bringing people together just to praise Allah?
Before you get too far, I understand what you're saying. I know you meant well, but you said something backwards.
Mm-hmm.
You said that people always gathered in masses first. No, just the opposite. When people came to follow Jesus, the Messiah, there was a very small band of people first.
Mm-hmm.
When people came to follow Rasulullah Muhammad, there was a very small band of people first. When people came to follow Moses, there was a very small group first, just his brother to be exact. And then by his example did he draw the masses. Mm-hmm. It was by Jesus the Messiah's pure heart and good works did people begin to follow him, because the Sanhedrin and them were controlling the law. They were making themselves look like they were the intellectuals, but he just looked sincere and pure, and by the grace of the Most High, which is his healing power, he started drawing people to his example. So we have already embarked upon a tabligh of spreading. Every week, the brothers from the community, you see the buses we have. They leave with the buses and they go to different places. Eventually, you're not going to see them on Saturdays, because every Saturday they go to Delaware, or they go to Boston, or they go to North Carolina, and just a whole busload of Ansars all go out and they propagate, they give books away. We also have a new thing we've embarked on, little teeny pamphlets, like two-page pamphlets, to just give people on a certain subject, like, who named you Muslim? The Muslims believe in the Messiah. Will the Messiah return? Little things to start spreading throughout the community, so that the people who would not be able to, let's say, buy a whole book or to take the time to read a whole book, will get a little spark of light in it. But the best way for you to help, my brother, is A, to come in and learn the language Arabic and learn how we teach, so that when you're out there propagating, you're not saying something different. If someone gets to a certain point and they ask you a question, sometimes when you're in a roll, as they say in America, they got a roll of conversation going, and someone asks them a question they don't know, they just come off the top of their head. They start to build on something and it comes out wrong, and then I have to come back around and say, no, the brother meant well, but this is what he really meant. But if people are properly taught, come in and be instructed properly, learn to live how we live, then when we send our brothers back out, which we do, out in the dunya to reach people, they'll all be saying one thing, they'll be of one accord, one voice, one spirit, one soul. Like I said, they said people have many gifts, but it's all one spirit. That's what it speaks about when it speaks about speaking in tongues. Everybody has many gifts, gifts of prophecy, gifts of this, but all one spirit. We all must have that one spirit, open our mouths and let the Almighty speak through us, through his scriptures. They didn't mean that you just open your mouth and rattle on. It meant by an intake of all of the scriptures and an understanding of the Holy Scriptures, regardless of where you go, we all will be there. When you see me, you'll see Christ. When you see you, you'll see Christ. When you see your sister, you'll see Christ, because we will be at one with Christ the way he was one with his heavenly Father, and one with Muhammad the way he was one with his heavenly Father. You follow? It has to be a certain thing. It can't be guesses and opinions. We all have to dress alike, think alike, walk alike, and do it in accord to the Holy Scriptures, not the way we feel. So when a person says, why do I eat that way? Because the prophets ate like that. Why do I pray this way? Because the prophets prayed that way. Why do you talk like that? Because the prophets talk that language. Why do you dress like that? Because the prophets dress like that. That's what we must do. And this is why, when you read throughout the Bible, you find that they give three different types of characters of Jesus the Messiah. One character they give is obviously that of a man. Okay? The next one they give is that of the Son of God. I'm using God for the people who need to hear it that way. Allah. Right? And the next one is the Son of a Man. Now they separate his nature as a man from that as the Son of Man. The Son of Man made him the Messiah, the Anointed One. Right? The Son of the Most High made him of the seraphim, like the angels, an incarnation of the Spirit in the flesh. And the human part made him the Son of Mary. But in these characters, which we find in the Quran, as we gave Jesus a Ruh, gave him the Holy Spirit, we call him Isa and Maryam, the Son of Mary, and we call him a Nebi, a prophet. If all these characters portray three degrees that you and I must also portray. We are all human beings first. We have to remember that when we go out to propagate. We all are endowed with the Holy Spirit, the breath of life that the Almighty has put in us since the foundation of the world. And with the truth, we have an obligation to human beings, which gives us a threefold nature. But all three folds must be in one accord. They all must be one. Like they say, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, but they are all one. Father, the Heavenly Father, Son, the human being, and Holy Ghost, the angel Gabriel, or Jibril, who brings the revelations to the prophet, the Holy Spirit. So we must have an example to follow. And the last and best of examples after Jesus was the Comforter, who he said would come after him, which was none other than Muhammad. So we have to look like that, dress like that. Yes, we are already starting to spread our teachings across the world. We're now reaching out further. But we know we got to crawl before we walk. So we're starting with little pamphlets and open the doors to Arabic classes for people who are not in the community yet, so they can come on Saturdays and Sundays and start studying Arabic. Little things that we're trying to do, inshallah, we'll reach more people that way.
You have been listening to The True Life, sponsored by the original Tents of Kedar, located at 717 Bushwick Avenue in Brooklyn, New York. You are also invited to attend the questions and answers class every Sunday from 1 p.m. to 6 p.m. in the Hall of Knowledge at 548 Hart Street in Brooklyn, New York. And now, more profound than ever before, the Pamphlets of Peace, offered by the master teacher and spiritual guide, Es-Sayyid El-Imam Isa El-Hadi El-Mahdi, covering such topics as Who's Who on the Planet Earth? The Resurrection? Who was Noble Drew Ali? Who was Jesus' father? Who was Marcus Garvey? St. Paul, disciple or deceiver? And much, much more. Also, to aid in your spiritual growth, we have a beautifully crafted hand-woven prayer rug designed by Es-Sayyid El-Imam Isa El-Hadi El-Mahdi. We also have a large assortment of prayer beads, Nubian and Sufi oils, and incense. The original Tents of Kedar would like for you to write or call us and let us know how the true life has changed your life. Remember, above all things, truth is truth.